Nearly every sprinter has heard or been told that a key to faster acceleration is to, quote, get low. The idea here is that if we can project out at a lower angle relative to the ground, we can orient our force production in a more horizontal manner, leading to faster acceleration. Coaches will debate whether or not this is good advice, mainly because going lower than what your strength allows for can cause you to stumble, overstride, sidestep, or even get injured. While we certainly should avoid going so low that we fall on our face when we sprint, I believe it's important to train in a way that maximizes our ability to project horizontally at relatively lower angles, maintain greater trunk flexion during acceleration, and to be able to endure greater angles of knee flexion during ground contact. Before we go forward, it's important to understand that, you know, most of this discussion is going to be centered around acceleration, and at some point when you sprint, you will have to rise into a tall position. But for the purpose of accelerating as fast as possible, and considering that acceleration is what gets us to top speed, today we're going to talk about staying low in acceleration and how you can train in a way that maximizes your ability to stay low coming out of the blocks and going through your drive phase. The first concept we're going to cover today related to, you know, staying low when you sprint is that the direction of force application matters more than the magnitude or amount of force that you apply to the ground. Research suggests that the direction in which we apply force into the ground is more important than the magnitude of force produced. For example, if you were to apply very large forces in either a forward direction, such as when you're braking or slowing down, or in a purely vertical direction, one would not sprint as fast as someone who applied that force in a more rearward or horizontal direction. When we see someone like Terrence Laird, who can run really fast but is also really skinny at the same time, this is because his ability to apply force in the right direction is highly optimized, even though his overall total capability to produce force in something like a squat or a deadlift is probably not very high. So he's a perfect example of someone who applies force in the right direction, and that's why he sprints fast. Whereas if he just tried to produce as much force as possible but was not sending it in the right direction, he wouldn't run nearly as fast as he does. In a study titled Relationships Between Ground Reaction Impulse and Sprint Start Acceleration Performance in Team Sport Athletes by Kawamori, Nosaka, and Newton, two quotes stuck out to me as being relevant to this discussion. The faster subjects in the study applied ground reaction impulses in a more horizontal direction, which allowed them to achieve better sprint acceleration. They also stated, "This study showed that the magnitude of relative ground reaction impulse, aka resultant impulse, is not correlated with sprint acceleration performance, and that the direction of impulse application is likely more important, so that applying impulse in a more horizontal direction may lead to faster sprint acceleration." Another study called Technical Ability of Force Application as a Determinant Factor of Sprint Performance by Morin, Edward, and Samazino states the following: "Force application technique is a determinant factor of field 100-meter sprint performance, which is not the case for the amount of total force that subjects were able to apply onto the ground. It seems that the orientation of the total force applied onto the supporting ground during sprint acceleration is more important to performance than its amount." So to summarize, the direction within which we apply force is more important than the total amount of force that we can apply. You can stomp your way down the track and not run very fast if the force is being applied in every other direction and instead of, you know, horizontally and backward into the ground. The earlier we are in the sprint, the more this force will be oriented horizontally relative to the ground. As our body rises through acceleration into upright sprinting, our ability to produce horizontal forces decreases and force production becomes predominantly oriented vertically relative to the ground. The fastest sprinters in the world show the lowest decrease in horizontal force production as they accelerate, such that they can continue to apply horizontal force deeper into the sprint. And if you think about it, you know, as the ground is moving under you faster and faster, it becomes much harder to strike the ground and produce horizontal force. It's a lot easier to just strike the ground vertically and bounce off of it. So the better sprinters are able to continue to apply horizontal force as those time constraints become more and more, you know, constraining, as the ground moving under them is faster and faster and it's harder to produce horizontal force. The top sprinters are able to continue to do that deeper into the race, and this is one reason why they're able to continue to accelerate, because they're applying force in the right direction for a greater proportion of the sprint. So how does getting low and directing force horizontally relate to one another? If we accept that the direction within which we apply force is an important factor for sprint performance, we then need to find tactics that can help us achieve a better direction of force application. With regards to the sprint start and early acceleration, achieving greater trunk flexion, so basically having your torso oriented more forward, and knee flexion angles, so having greater knee bend when you contact the ground, will help us produce force in a more horizontal direction. The caveat is that we need to be strong enough and skilled enough to support our body in these more aggressive positions, and achieving trunk flexion at toe off and knee flexion at toe down is what we would generally call being low. The study titled Effective Velocity-Based Loading on Acceleration, Kinetics, and Kinematics During Sprint Towing by Bentley, Sinclair, Atkins, Metcalf, and Edmondson stated the following. Along with increased peak knee flexion, the authors believe that the increased trunk flexion at toe-off enables the athlete to increase their horizontal force application. So they're basically saying that if you can orient your trunk or your torso forward, and when you hit the ground you're able to have deeper knee flexion, aka being low, this will allow you to produce more horizontal force and improve your acceleration. With this in mind, we can frame the concept of getting low in sprinting as achieving higher levels of knee flexion at foot strike or when you touch down on the ground, and higher levels of trunk flexion at toe off or when your toe comes off the ground. This makes sense considering a flexed knee during ground contact allows for a more horizontally oriented shin, and a flexed trunk allows for the body to be more horizontally oriented overall, while also shifting the center of mass forward, which makes it easier to push the body forward during acceleration. So this brings up the question of, how do you train to actually get low in sprinting? We can understand it conceptually, but if you don't know how to apply it into your training, then what's the point, right? Well, in my opinion, there are a few aspects of training to consider as it relates to achieving lower angles during acceleration sprinting. Here we'll discuss both physical aspects of development as well as skill and technique development. So the first thing to consider is sleds and strength development. From a physical training perspective, resisted sprinting with sled towing and getting stronger in the gym are foundational if you want to make significant changes in your ability to get low when you sprint. Looking back at some of the research we've already discussed, sled towing is a good way to manipulate trunk and knee flexion angles during sprinting, allowing us to generate force in a more horizontal orientation. Looking again at a study called Effect of Velocity-Based Loading on Acceleration, Kinetics, and Kinematics, they stated that results indicated that sled towing affected trunk, knee, and ankle joint kinematics. They also said there was a trend toward greater trunk flexion as sled loading increased. So using sled loads in your training and resisted sprints with sleds will help you achieve greater trunk flexion and knee flexion angles if performed with the intent to do so, meaning that you need to both use the sled and also intend to drive your torso forward, get into that deep knee flexion during ground contact. You know, you can use the sled and use it improperly, or you can use the sled and have the proper intent to fire out low, really produce a lot of horizontal propulsion, keep your torso low, keep that trunk flexion, and keep good knee flexion when you contact the ground. You can use either a waist or a shoulder harness, it's up to you, but a waist harness might be preferred. The study titled Impact of Harness Attachment Point on Kinetics and Kinematics During Sled Towing by Bentley, Atkins, Edmondson, Metcalf, and Sinclair stated the following. Previous researchers have highlighted net horizontal impulses and propulsive force as being key to achieving high acceleration. As such, it would be seen that the waist harness is more suitable when training for the acceleration phase of sprinting. It seems apparent that the kinematic alterations caused by the waist harness made the line of action more horizontal, resulting in greater net horizontal impulse. So basically, if you use a waist harness when you sprint, it's going to make it easier for you to direct all of your forces in a more horizontal manner, which is going to allow you to sprint lower and ultimately accelerate faster. By using a sled with a load that causes around a 20% velocity decrement, you can go higher or lower, but 20% is a good range to start with, and a waist harness, we can create an environmental constraint that encourages us to generate our force production in a more horizontal manner, while also allowing for us to feel what it's like to sprint with greater hip and knee flexion. Over time, we might be able to achieve both physical and skill-oriented adaptations that can help us sprint faster without resistance. From a physical standpoint, we know that sled towing can improve power output and counter-movement jump, and I personally believe that sleds can cause tissue adaptations in the muscles and tendons of the leg that will also help us be stronger and be more effective when we sprint. In the gym, getting stronger in large ranges of motion will help lay a foundation of strength that can support your body as you sprint in these more aggressive positions. Considering knee flexion angle at touchdown is related to one's ability to direct force horizontally into the ground, building strength in positions with an acute knee angle makes logical sense as a general stimulus that should be included. This could be done with a deep squat, a high box push step up, or a rack step up, as well as performing lunges with maximal knee flexion. While these general exercises might not cause any direct improvement in your ability to sprint, they will help lay a foundation of strength and range of motion access, which can set you up to then perform sled sprints more effectively. From a skill or technique standpoint, training with a sled can allow us to achieve lower projection and joint angles, which could affect our vestibular system, which is sort of like our balance and, you know, our awareness in space type of system, and give us some kinesthetic context for what it feels like to sprint in a more horizontally directed manner. Over time, if we can learn what it feels like to do this while pulling a sled, we may be able to bring some of this technique and feel over into our unresisted sprints, and then be able to sprint lower out of the blocks, aggressively, more horizontally out of the blocks, if we transition from using sleds into then using sprints without a sled. If all we ever do is sprint without a sled, it is challenging to get into positions with deeper trunk and knee flexion. Without any kind of environmental constraint, the body will typically default to whatever it is used to. Also, being more aggressive with projection angles without a sled can be, you know, a bit scary at first, as it feels like you might fall down, stumble, or, you know, get hurt in some way. Because of this, using a sled on its own or paired with unresisted sprints can help train the brain to be comfortable sprinting with greater trunk and knee flexion. And over time, we can then try to mimic these technical qualities when we sprint without resistance. If you start with heavier loads, you can get into very aggressive positions at lower velocities, which will give you more time exposure to what those positions feel like. As time goes on, the sled load can be reduced to increase the velocity of the sprints, while still aiming to achieve the same projection angles you felt in the heavier sleds. Over time, this can acquaint your brain with the feeling of firing out low and producing a good balance of horizontal and vertical force, and hopefully allow you to get as low as possible, or as optimal, for your current strength and sprint capabilities. Now, with the concept of optimal in mind, we gotta ask, how low is too low? So to maximize our horizontal propulsion as we sprint, we need to get enough hip height to allow for us to reorient our limbs and actively strike the ground each step. If our hips do not rise at all, we'll simply crash into the ground and have to catch ourselves before we're able to apply any propulsive forces. Whereas if we do get off the ground a little bit and create some separation between our hips and the ground, we can reorient our limbs and have enough time and space to strike like a hammer into the ground on the next step without stumbling or falling. Sometimes when we try to go too low, we end up popping up as a result of excessive braking or in an attempt by the brain to not fall or stumble. Optimal hip height would be achieved when we project vertically enough to cycle our legs to prepare for the next ground strike, but no more than that. Excessively low hip height will lead to stumbling or sidestepping, and excessively high hip height will lead to increased flight times without a proportional amount of horizontal movement. If you look like you're going up and down, but without a lot of, you know, horizontal translocation through the air, then you're probably going too high each step, and you'd need to direct things a little bit more horizontally to be most effective. So in conclusion, to wrap things up, I do believe it is worth training in a way that can lead to you being able to orient forces more horizontally during early acceleration, also known as staying low. We can use resisted sprinting in the form of sled towing to familiarize the body with applying force horizontally, and over time this can help train the brain to be comfortable firing out of the blocks in an aggressive, forward manner. In the gym, we can include exercises which strengthen our legs through large ranges of motion, including deep knee flexion, and this can help lay down the foundation of general strength, which will be beneficial for us, so that strength in certain positions is not a limiting factor for our sprint ability. When we sprint, we can aim to keep our torso flexed at the hips, such that it is easier to produce horizontal force, and our weight is distributed in a way that is effective for acceleration. Just make sure that you're not going so low that you crash and stumble, and also be sure that you're actually flexing the torso, not just tucking your chin. You know, sometimes people will think that they're flexing their torso from the hips, but really all they're doing is bending their head down. So it's counterintuitive, but sometimes if you actually keep your head up or at least neutral in line with your spine, it'll be easier to get your torso down, because if your head goes down, then to balance, your torso is going to stay up a little bit. So allow your head to be just in line with your spine or even looking up just very slightly, and then allow your torso to drop so that you have that torso or trunk flexion, which will allow you to apply force more horizontally and accelerate more effectively. Over time, as you transition from an emphasis on heavy sleds to focusing more on moderate loads and unloaded sprints, you can attempt to sprint with an overall lower position. So if you're going to take anything away from this video, it is one that staying low is important if, to you, staying low means producing horizontal force, you know, orienting your body in a forward direction, applying force horizontally back into the ground, and really maximizing our ability to produce horizontal force during acceleration. To achieve this, we should start with heavy sled loads so that the velocity is slower and it's allowing you to get into the positions we want to see more easily. And then over time, you transition to lighter sleds, which will make it harder to get into those same positions. But as you've over time learned what it feels like to do it with a heavier sled, then you learn how to do it with a lighter sled, then you can learn how to do it without a sled. And you can also, you know, as you're doing sled pulls, it doesn't mean you just have to do only resisted sprints. You know, you can go resisted for half the workout and unresisted for the other half. You can go back and forth between resisted and unresisted. It's up to you how you do it. That's sort of the art of training, is figuring out those little details. But what I personally do is I start off heavier, and then I make sure that at least a couple of the sprints within the workout are without a sled. And then over time, I reduce the sled load, and then I increase the number of unresisted sprints eventually. So that way I'm targeting, you know, learning what it feels like to get low, what it feels like to produce horizontal force early on in the year with the heavy sled. Then I transition to the medium loaded sled, where I'm still trying to produce a lot of horizontal force, get that aggressive trunk angle and everything like that. But it's a little bit harder to do because the sled load is less, the velocity of movement is higher, and it's going to be harder to achieve those aggressive positions. And I'm still, you know, at that point, I'm still contrasting between resisted and unresisted. It's just that the load of the resisted sprints is a little bit lower. Then I transition to an even lighter sled. I might lengthen the distance out a little bit, and then I pair that with unresisted sprints. So that way I'm now trying to, you know, still work on those same concepts and technical qualities of staying low, getting that trunk angle forward, getting that deep knee flexion when I contact the ground, but it's getting harder to do that as I reduce the sled load. And then eventually, when you're close to competition, you might not use any sleds at all, and you'll only be doing unresisted sprinting. But by that point, you should have enough time to learn what it feels like to fire out with a lower trunk angle, a more aggressive flexed trunk angle, hitting the ground with a more aggressively flexed knee angle. And you should be able to see some improvement in your ability to sprint without the sled if you've done this over a long enough period of time. It's not going to happen in 1 week, it's not going to happen in 1 day, but over the course of many weeks and months, if you do this transition from heavier sleds to lighter sleds, and then you also include some unresisted sprints within there where you're trying to instill these technical qualities, I think we can see an improvement in our ability to stay low as we accelerate out of the blocks and overall improve our acceleration and run faster. So hopefully you guys got something out of this video. Let me know if you have any questions below. Happy to, you know, see what you guys have to say. But if you've done something like this in the past, let me know how it went for you. But other than that, I'll catch you guys next time. This is Cody Bidlow with SprintingWorkouts.com and ATHLETE.X signing off.